Mr. Bieber, how do you interpret the Bulgarian demands for the language and identity, Macedonian language and identity, but also the demands for Macedonia to give up the Macedonian minority? Is such a thing possible at all?
Well, I mean, everything is possible. I don't think that's a very reasonable demand. I think that's clear. And I think nobody in the European Union and other countries feel that this is a reasonable request from the Bulgarian government. It's also very surprising. I mean, Bulgaria had not previously said that it would make it a condition for North Macedonia to begin accession talks. So the demands came out of the blue. We all know the reservations which Bulgaria has had on some joint understanding of history, on language, also on the Macedonian minority, but it's never made this a condition for EU talks. So in that sense, it is rather unexpected, and also I think is met with a lot of, let's say, lack of understanding and a bit of surprise in many EU capitals.
What is the mood, by your information, what is the mood in the European Union about these demands?
Well, I think it's clear that these demands have little sympathy, as I've mentioned. I think it's for two reasons. First of all, it's always a bit of a problem when a single country blocks a decision which has been agreed upon. Even when France blocked negotiations last year, there was a lot of criticism of France's position. And, you know, it's important to remember that while I also thought that the decision of President Macron was a bad decision, at least it was based on the questions of the enlargement process, on merits, I mean, not of North Macedonia or Albania, but much more on the larger problem of the enlargement process. And it was met a lot of criticism. In the case of Bulgaria, there was no preparation. It came out of the blue. It came after there was an agreement already in March of this year, after many years in which Bulgaria has not said that this was an obstacle. So it really, I think, in many EU cities and capitals, is seen as really frivolous and abusing the veto power of a single member state.
Is there a way out of this situation for Macedonia? And is it possible for the European Union to put pressure in the upcoming period to Bulgaria to give up on its demands?
I mean, I think basically there is a chance, of course there is one, because it is a decision of Bulgaria. It's one where, of course, each member state has the power to veto it, but veto powers come at a cost. So if a country blocks a decision, it might have to pay it in another field. So where other governments feel that they have able to put more pressure on Bulgaria, because saying, if this is so important to you, we disagree with your position, then there might be a pushback in other areas, one where Bulgaria might pay a price it's not willing to pay. So first of all, there is a way out. It might require some face saving for the Bulgarian government, or it might even have to wait until the elections are finished in Bulgaria. I think the best thing which the government of North Macedonia can do is keep up channels with communication with other EU member states. And I think the current government has a very positive image in many EU capitals. I mean, I think if it weren't for this government, there wouldn't be this much sympathy. I mean, I get a sense in many EU cities, the message has always been, also in the United States, the message has been, in fact, this government deserves to start talks. It should start talks. It's shown its willingness to be pragmatic, reform-oriented, and also willing to compromise on those issues. And I think this pays off now. But so this is what the government should do, is continue maintaining those good ties and sending the message of that North Macedonia is committed to talks with the European Union. It wants to join the European Union. It believes in the values. But at the same time, I also think that there's no need for, and the North Macedonia should not feel the pressure to have to, in a certain way, renegotiate these questions. I mean, they're controversial historical issues. They should be left to historians. I'm not saying that the history told in North Macedonia is right in all of those questions, but neither is the one in Bulgaria. But it's not up for prime ministers to decide, or foreign ministers, or the European Union, but it's up for historians to decide. And if North Macedonia sticks to this message, and, you know, shows that it's pragmatic but also determined on this issue, I do think there's a way out of it. I wish it would be concluded by the end of this year, but it might take a bit longer, but we'll have to see. But I don't think it's going to become a decade-long stone around the neck of North Macedonia like the Greek blockage has been.
Can the Bulgarian veto open the Pandora's box in the European Union, and is a domino effect possible in the Western Balkans?
Well, I mean, Bulgaria is not the first country which is using its veto powers. We've had this previously, not just Greece for North Macedonia, but we've had this that, for example, during the accession of Slovenia, Italy was threatening the veto, maybe not using it always. Croatia and Slovenia had these issues. So again, this is nothing new. It's just that Bulgaria is using it in a very blazoned, but also a very undiplomatic way, which has destroyed a lot of political capital. Of course, this will continue because as long as individual member states have the power to block accession process, this risk is there. And it can be abused for all kinds of reasons because you have a government which is against enlargement.
Mr. Bieber, thank you for this interview.
Thank you.